Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. This is the season finale, season one of the show. And I am joined this week by the Rejected Zone Heavy Metal Hooligan, Mikkey Vago. Welcome to the show.
Just for having us, Molly.
No bother at all. So yeah, you're the last one of 2020 before it takes a little break and moves on to season two in January. So you're the big finish, so to speak. So we'll start with the boring question because we do with everyone else. I'm not going to change that.
Yep.
How did you get into pro wrestling?
All right, so I'm going to prefix this by saying I'm a bit older than everyone thinks I am. So I do remember a time when I wasn't into wrestling, like as far back as I can remember. So you're talking late 80s, early 90s. That was my era when I got into it. So you like your Hogan's, your Ultimate Warriors, Savage, Big Boss Man, all your big characters. My granny, she was mad into it, and she was the one who had the Sky. So she was the one that she had to record it off the Sky in the Sunday night, whatever the night was on. So you're out badgering your mum round there on the Monday morning. You get us the VHS at the time to watch the WWF pay-per-views. And by the time there was only the big four in your Rumble, your SummerSlam, WrestleMania, Survivor Series. But that was when I got into it, where it was like the really big characters and everyone had a job.
Absolutely, yeah. Well, that moved on to things like, of course, you had the Bin Man, you had Dumpster Drosy, you had TL Hopper, you had all the classics. Obviously, that's the first two that come to mind because they're just the most out there. You had a dentist, of course. You had Isaac Yanko.
So
it was the characters that really struck first of all. That seems to be quite fitting for where you mainly play your trade, which is WrestleZone, because they are all about that kind of big character things. So how'd you go from being the fan to eventually trying the wrestling stuff?
Well, obviously watching it that far back, and then I was maybe 15, 16, I maybe wasn't watching it as much or at all even. And for a period of about maybe 10 years, I didn't watch anything. There was nothing I watched. And then about probably about mid-20s, I was in a pal's house and he had it on. And I was like, And then like say, Ric Flair, he was still there. It's like, these guys were wrestling when I was a kid. How can these still be on the go? And I got mad into it again. And probably about late 2013, 14, when the ICW documentary was on BBC, and I was like watching it, and I was like, guys like Grado and whatever, it's like, these guys are just like I am. It's like, if they can do this, why can I not give it a go? So I looked into it, like I said, that must have been early 2014. Find wrestlers when they're at the school, an academy. So I messaged them maybe about March, April time. And at the time, my wife, she was 2 months pregnant. So I explained this to her, like to get clearance basically. So look, wrestlers when I've got this academy, want to go do this, whatever, da da da. And she had a mad fit thinking I was just doing a jack in my job. That was me. I was going to be a wrestler full time. That was it. Everything was wrestling. I was getting any pay until I was good enough to go on into like WWE or whatever. So after I had explained it to her, it's like, no. This is like part time. I'll still be doing my actual job at the time. So once it was all right with her, that was fine. So that was Anarchy 2014, would have been May that year. I was in the crowd for that one, and 2 weeks later, I was in the academy training with the guys that I just watched that show 2 weeks previous, and nice. From there, it's just been...
So 2014 would have been the ladder match. It would have been Thunder Buddies.
Yeah, I was
against Ed Grado Grado and Scott Hoy. That was it.
That was
a fantastic show. So strange thing that I'm seeing you wrestle now, and I was in the crowd with. I would have been in the crowd with you during that show. It was the one time I went front row for one of the shows until I found the beauty of the balcony, and that was the balcony forever.
Yeah.
But so 2014 then. So I've got here you made your debut in the year following, in your hometown. Would that be right? In Montrose?
Technically, yes. That's where I like to say I got my debut. I'd actually wrestled previously. 2014 would have been, I want to say September. It was a Proving Ground show.
All right.
And I wrestled under my real name. And I was in a black singlet with kick pads, and it just wasn't a look for me. I thought, no, when I do this properly, I'm doing it the way I should be doing it, like they are now, the cut off jeans, t-shirt, whatever. So yeah, the debut for Mikkey Vago, first match was at Montrose, the hometown Montrose, yeah.
So we'll not labour on your first match, because it sounds like you weren't totally happy with it. So what was it like going for your first match? Because Proving Grounds, that's primarily marketed towards like friends and family coming round.
Basically.
So what was it like going into your first match?
The one at Montrose.
Either one you want to decide that is your first. We'll go with that.
Proving Grounds is a bit different because I'd only been training. Well, it was September. I started in end of May, start of June. So I'd only had maybe 2-3 months training at that point. It was a tag match. It was me and Archer against Sean Sterling and Kieran Garrick. It was a tag match. And I was nervous as anything for that match. But then, debuting as Mikkey Vago in Montrose, I was a lot more comfortable in the gimmick. It's basically just me. There is no gimmick there. It's just that Heavy Metal Hooligan's neck level name. It's me. But yeah, I was a lot more comfortable in Montrose.
So, it's the last time we'll mention Proving Grounds. So you've teamed with Chris Archer, of course. That's where you are now. From 2015 onwards, you've been part of Dogs of War that became The Rejected. Did you instantly, in that first match, you used to think, oh, this guy's on my same kind of wavelength and this could be something?
Me and Archer were close anyway, because at the time, this was before WrestleZone had the actual academy. We were training in a scout hut. There was no ring up. It was just mats and Ken, you got the ring up maybe before shows at the time. So it was like one night a week. It was a Sunday night. The newer trainees were in. And Archer was always in. He was in both nights. He was in the nights that the show talent was in, plus the nights the trainees were in. So he was always a guy that was around, and he always had advice to give. So it's like we were good pals before that point anyway. And then, obviously, we had the tag match together, thought this might work. And then towards, the first was born end October. So I had about a month and a half off. Come back about middle of November, start of December. And they were like, look, next month is January with Summer Hill. Nathan Mahal, it was Overleaf at the time, with the first show of the year. Look, you're going to be doing this thing. Archer's going to be in a match with William Sterling. You're going to come out. And then from that point on, you and Archer are going to be this tag team. I think. At the time, I thought it was a rib. I was like, I've only been here since like June, and now you're throwing me in. But like I said, Archer to me is always a good friendship. Like, even now, he's kind of considered him a brother. But yeah,
it's certainly escalated really quickly, because you were tag team champion towards the end of that year as well with Archer. WrestleZone, then it was against was it Mr. P and Kaden Garrick you end up defeating. So it's kind of like kind of like that full circle. Your first opponent, you end up defeating him for a title within the year. So what was it like getting your hold of that championship for the first time? Because wrestling belts are just, they're all gorgeous belts, but what was it like actually winning one?
Obviously, the first time is always memorable. I mean, that, like I said, that first year, a lot of that year, I thought they were just pulling their leg for things. Like I said, they had the debut at the start of the year, being only 6 months in, whatever. We were at the Regal Rumble, we were in a six-man tag, and Grado was on the opposite side of us, and I was only maybe three matches in at this point. I was like, I'm a guy like Grado, that's a joke. And they're like, no, you're in there, a six-man tag, okay. Then Anarchy that year, maybe a month before, you're going to be in the six-man tag with Looking Sharp's going to be in your team. I'm like, all right, okay, who's teaming with Thunderbird? He's a D-Bond of Luke. No, he's not. It's like, oh, yeah. I was like, okay.
Was there a moment where they all went, right, someone's going through a table afterwards, and did everyone just step back and let Archer just stand there just go, it's me then, is it? Okay.
I believe it or not, Archer is crazy enough to volunteer for these types of things. Part of the reason I'm here now is to rein him in. that was Anarchy, and then obviously towards the end of the year we're getting title shots, and the Christmas Chaos last show of the year we win the titles. Obviously that's, and then that was the year Mick Foley was there, so he wasn't there when I think we were the first match out, and he wasn't at the venue at this point. So we went out, wrestled a match, well, we won the belts, we come back through the curtain, Mick Foley was sitting right on the other side of the curtain, he'd be watching our match. I was like, oh, was that mind was blown. That guy in the caliber, he's watching us, just four of us just knocking lumps at each other. It's unbelievable.
So yeah, just putting that into context, your first full year, you're in a match with one of the biggest stars in Scottish wrestling, still is. You're in the ring with now WWE Hall of Famer, Devon Dudley. Yep. And then you end the year by winning the title in front of the legendary Mick Foley. That sounds like the wildest, like, you couldn't have written a better first year.
A lot of that for first year, I just thought they were joking with pulling the leg, whatever. And it just kept getting better and better and better and better, and you kind of make it up.
Absolutely. And then you moved on to 2016, which was Anarchy. The undefeated team of yourself, Archer and Luke King Sharp.
Yeah, the greatest streak of sports entertainment.
The greatest streak of sports entertainment. Coming up against Bull Dempsey, the Hurricane, and Carlito.
Yeah.
What did you think when they approached you with that?
it was the same thing again. I thought they were just winding us up at this point. It's like, oh, you got D1 Dolby last year. Oh, you've got Carlito, Hurricane, and Bull Ben. Like, three of the four imports we've got this year, you're wrestling them all. No, you are. It's just speechless is what it is. We're very thankful for that, obviously, but yeah.
When I was looking, of course, I've watched WrestleZone since 2013, so I thought, I know most of what's happened. I don't remember everything because I've terrible memory as well, but yeah. I was going through just your cage match profile, and I was like going, wait, hang on. So just looking through the names you'd faced in your first 2 years, I was like, how have I not noticed this? It's like you've been in with some of the biggest names that they've brought in.
Yeah.
I mean, even more recently.
We had this running joke for a while after the 2016 Anarchy. That was the gimmick was changing. I was just going to be imports only, Mikkey Vago, and every Anarchy, that was it. I was just going to wrestle imports. It wasn't interesting everybody else.
Daniel, that could work when it comes back. It would have to be totally overhauled. You'd have to get the hair slicked back and get the whole the suit going and it would have to be a definite change, but. You know, Yeah, import only, Mikkey Vago.
Yeah.
So, speaking of Aberdeen Anarchy, I think, as you like to point out, you made me cry at Aberdeen Anarchy in 19. When that table match happened.
Yes, that table match.
That table match. And from my records here, you and Archer are undefeated in tables matches. But with a big with a big asterisk on the one at Anarchy, because you both went through tables. But anyway, I'm just going to... just unbelievable. So what was it like going into... I mean, when you go into Aberdeen Anarchies, of course, you faced Devon, you faced these three guys. Yeah. These are the biggest shows of WrestleZone's calendar. You get over 1,000 people there, especially when you're just starting. Do you feel the difference being in front of over 1,000 people, or is it just you concentrate on the match and just let your actions do the talking?
I find it easier the more people there is there, because it's harder to pick out faces and voices where they're coming from, as opposed to maybe you're wrestling in front of 30 people. You can see generally every face in the crowd, whereas the ballroom is a kind of big, massive place, and we've had 1,000, 1,200 people in there at a time.
Everyone just kind of like blurs. Yeah,
My first anarchy, like I wasn't nervous in the slightest until everyone kept going up and saying, "Are you nervous yet?" Like, well, I wasn't before, I am now.
it's like they're just going, "Oh, you should be." Be nervous. I don't have a note of last year's. What was the match you were in last year at the Beach Rider Centre?
Triple tag team number one contender.
Of course it was. Foundation of the Future, of course. Yeah. Unfortunately,
I mean, we've all, every anarchy we've had, we've been involved in some sort of big match.
Of course, just dipping back, 2017, the title versus hair match against the Sterling Brothers as well. So you're in the 5 years that you've been in WrestleZone wrestling, you've pretty much ticked off some huge moments, huge matches. Picked up a couple four time tag team champion there.
Four time.
And faced pretty much every team that's been brought in. You got the outfit, you got the Foundation in the Future, you got, I'm sure you probably had matches with Swift and Lions when they were champions as well. So
I don't think we had it. I think that's one team we never faced.
No.
I don't think so.
So it's never going to happen now, unfortunately. But I mean, who knows? Wrestlers don't stay retired forever. We all know that. It's just a
joke. You loved it too much. Exactly. He'll be back.
So as far as heroes then for wrestling, you grew up in the cartoon age of everyone had a job, new gen kind of era. Was there anyone that you kind of based your style or your look on growing up?
Being that young and the time I went to it, like the big guy was always Hogan. Like that was the hero. He was the kind of beat everybody. But then I was always a big fan of the Undertaker. Even when he came in as a heel, there's something about him. Kenny was doing all the when he did the he could not do any do the sit up. And he was like, yeah, that's cool. So he's always been one of the top guys. But when I was in my teens, I really got into I was flicking the channels at my granny's one day, and I came across ECW. And anyone who knows me knows I'm a massive Raven fan, which you can probably tell by the gear I wear at the ring and whatever. But yeah, Raven was always the big one.
Yeah, now you say that, yeah, absolutely. Cut off shorts, the T-shirt and all that kind of stuff, the heavy metal vibe. Not as grungy. But still, that kind of the heavy metal, obviously, because Heavy Metal Hooligan. Another thing I'll go brought up, I was speaking to Caleb previous interview, which I hope you've listened to. Brought up the Gala Day emergency door. thought?
Still the greatest finish I've ever come up with.
Was it? I was going to ask, what were your thoughts on that? And you just answered it. So, yeah.
It remains my finest moment, if not one of my finest wrestling moments.
It was just yeah. I've seen a clip of it, and I'm just like, I've seen it in other places as well, but it's never ended a match. It's always kind of, they've knocked like, and someone's, they've let them back in.
The only downside is the footage isn't that great of it. That's the only downside to that. But yeah, that is the finest gala moment I've ever had, and probably will remain so.
Well, especially now, there's no galas on. It's not being ever again. So, undefeated tail matches, debut 2015, amazing matches. But one of your highlights, I'm sure, is your journey in the 128 Mega Tournament of Doom, hosted by SWN at the start of lockdown, where somehow you ended up in the final, and somehow Adam was still alive at the end of it because he had so many managers to put on, which you led to the manager rule that effectively happened further onwards with other tournaments. But he does have a question that he came up with. He put, favourite tournament Doom of manager, and why is it the Chuckle Brothers?
Oh, it's not Chuckle Brothers. I mean, they're up there. I mean, to narrow it down to one, off of however many, there was 60-odd maybe.
I think the last graphic that went up was, you and just everyone we could possibly think of, and then Grant had Saturdays.
So I think it was a joke. After maybe the second or third round, I wish I'd have said, look, this is going to get more and more ridiculous. Thinking I've just got it, maybe that was it. That would be it. I'd beat the next round. Just jokingly saying, look, this is going to get more and more ridiculous. And if I get to the final, I'm having everyone I've had up to this point in one graphic. Thinking, there's no danger, I'll be there. And I got closer and closer and closer.
I know, I mean, I'll be honest, I was really surprised that you just kept moving forward. And I was, but you're in Aberdeen. Not many people will probably know who Mikkey Vago is. But clearly the managers and the graphics and the support was behind you for the whole tournament. So many managers can pick one of Chuck Rush. Speaking of Grant McIver, he has a question. I don't know if it's going to be your kind of thing, but I'm sure you'll have an answer. Favourite member of Boyzone was his question.
Boyzone. I couldn't name one member of Boyzone.
Well, sadly, I know
that one. Another one, Robbie Williams.
Let's take that. That's Ronan Keaton is the.
Ronan Keaton, well, that's the only one I can name then.
I think you might have asked it because there's a member called Mikey. I don't know if that's been brought up at all, but no. Mikey. So every time we've got Grant coming on, he's going to be part of season two, so I'm sure you can ask him whatever questions you want about heavy metal members that he won't be able to answer either. So speaking of heavy metal stuff, Scotty has a question as well. Scotty Swift, he's put, you can only have one Motorhead album. What is it?
Didn't I do that to me? One Motorhead album. You could have any three for the first four. It'd be Ace of Spades, Overkill, or Bomber. And my personal favourite is Overkill. It's just the perfect album, in my opinion. There's not a bad track on it. So if I'm just getting one, that's the one I'm having.
Well, I've outside of the wrestling stuff, and obviously Ace of Spades, everyone knows that song. I don't know that much about Motorhead, so I'd probably go for the best of Motorhead. I was going to pick one in general.
Oh, I never thought of that. I had that one.
I think that's probably his partridge I'm going to get on this podcast. But and he's also asked, who is the Geordie Rocket?
The Geordie Rocket?
Yeah.
But he's a past wrestler for Newcastle. That's as much as I know about him.
Sorry, the worst. Did you say the worst?
Mask.
Oh, the
mask. He's a masked wrestler for Newcastle.
Ah, right, okay. Do you know the reason why he's asked that? Do you possibly...
Yes, I do. because it's he may or may not be the alter ego of one of the WrestleZone wrestlers.
Oh, right. Okay. Well, mysteries. Yeah. I've got Scotty again next week, so I'll see if I can
get the debut.
See that now. The Johnny Rocket and Blue Thunder. Yeah, that combo. Cool. Yeah.
He's a big fan of Dave.
So the other thing that, of course, people will recognise you for is your face paint, which started, is it mid-last year you started donning the face paint a little bit, and then it's just kind of escalated?
The Halloween match we had against the Kings, that was the first time I wore it.
And just once you put it on, you're just like...
So when was that? Just keep it. 2 years ago, maybe? And then, like I said, that was just the... Like Headbanger Mosh or Thrasher. They used to have the two triangles under his eyes. Thought, that's what I'm having that. That'll be it. It's a bit Halloween-y. It's as Halloween-y as I'm going to get. And then a couple of the guys were like, hey, that suits you. You should keep that. So I said, okay. So started messing about with it and having different designs or whatever. And then we had one, I can't remember what show it was, but I went the full face instead, because I used to just have the black under the eyes or around the eyes, whatever. And there was one big show, I can't remember what show it was, but it was the full black and white face paint. I want to say Sting, it wasn't a Sting, but yeah, it was the full face. And ever since then, it's been, if it's a big show or a big match, it's the full black and white face paint. Otherwise, it's just the touches of the eyes or, yeah, that's my war paint.
Because war paint, So you take inspiration from, so you said Sting there would be like a bit of Road Warrior in there as well. Road Warriors, just the war.
Yeah, it's more for the music side of things than it is the wrestler. I mean, I know there's a few wrestlers worn the, obviously with the Warrior and Raven, he donned it, like the same kind of similar to what I'm using. But it's like I've taken stuff there. They like Kiss or King Diamond or just guys in the heavy metal world that wear face paint just to, what's the word I'm looking for? To just zizz up the gimmick, right, so to speak.
Yeah, it's just I think you're kind of positioned now where you're going to be the singles guy in The Rejected, because Caden Garrick became the prospect last year.
Yes.
And since that point, Garrick and Archer have been doing the team, and you've been venturing off into the singles title scene with a match with, I think it was Damien they end up facing for the title at some point. Was it Damien? Yeah.
No, I was in the four-way for the Tri-Counties. Yeah, Rowan Sterling and Jason Reed, Ryan Riley.
Yeah, and I had a match for the Undisputed Championship as well at some point. But yeah, anyway. Regardless, you're still kind of delving into the single scene.
Yeah, it seems to be getting booked that way. Yeah,
do you find that more of a challenge? So you don't have someone else to kind of bounce ideas off of. It's now just kind of yourself and your opponent. You don't have Archer in the corner.
I mean, it is, because I've always been a big tag team guy. Anyway, like even before I was a wrestler, I was always a big fan of tag team wrestling, and then getting into obviously being stuck with Archer for 5 years, it's just what I've gotten used to. Obviously you get the odd singles match here and there and whatever, but the majority of matches we've had is as a tag team. But if anything, it's good to get out of the comfort zone and go and do a singles match where you, like a tag match, you're obviously only doing maybe 50% of the work, if that. A singles match, you're in there for the whole time, and it's a completely different experience to work in a tag match, I'll say that. But yeah, I'm enjoying it so far. Yeah. Well, I say so far. I won't enjoy it till 11 stop.
So, of course, speaking of that four-way, you've seen video footage of it. You were pretty much bound to win it until there was some shenanigans with Ryan Riley and Alan Sterling somehow coming out with the championship himself. So is that pretty much your aspirations now moving forward once the shows begin? Kind of moving into continuing that singles run, or are you just quite happy just doing whatever, just wrestling?
I mean, I just go with the flow, just take it as it comes. I mean, obviously, I like more gold, That's obviously if you're a wrestler, that's what you strive to be. I mean, just getting good matches and different matches. That's what I'm all about. Just matches like I haven't had so far. Like a ladder matches or maybe a ladder match. Like to do that. Cage match. Love to do a cage match. I've wrestled in a cage.
The cage especially, I'm assuming you're loving because it's the old blue bar.
Old style. Yeah. Blue bar. So it's top notch.
I was around for the blue bar. When I started, it was a black bar cage when I started watching, but seeing it in like the flesh, the steel, it's just amazing to look at.
I don't think it matters as much about the colour, it's just the bars is what makes the cage.
Absolutely. Like it's all well good having the steel mesh and that, but the bars, that's the one you
over cage, I believe. Yeah.
That's the one you put your action figures on, because you can actually hold them up on it.
Yes.
as opposed to just going, they're holding on to the top and that's it. That's all you can do with the other ones. So as far as you grew up wrestling in the 90s. Were you the big Hasbro kind of guy, or are you just watching it?
Yes. I wouldn't say them all, but I didn't have them all. But yeah, still, they're still in my bag in my mum's, I believe. Still on the old Hasbro figures.
Oh man,
my brother, he was into it. I've got a younger brother, and he was into the. He got into it. He's 4 years younger than I am. So he caught the tail end of the Hasbros, but he was more the. The more articulated ones, the
Jacks and the Bone Crunchers. I remember the Bone Crunchers.
I didn't like them. I didn't think they were as good as the Hasbro ones.
I think my first one was the Bone Crunchers. It was a Draws figure. I'd never seen Draws wrestle, and by the time I'd actually properly watched, Draws wasn't wrestling anymore. So
yeah.
I had this really cool looking one. It looked like it had a kilt on. It was like all piercings, and he looked amazing. But yeah, Draws, and then Ken Shamrock. Everyone did the stunner because that's all I knew.
Yep.
And Goldust was their one because he had a jacket. I bought him because he had a jacket.
Oh,
I wish I still had them. Exactly. Oh, absolutely. There was a time where I begged my folks to go get me Al Snow because he came with head.
Because he had a head, yeah.
Yeah, I begged them, and eventually I broke them down, and they went, and unfortunately it was sold out or it had been withdrawn at that point, and they came on with a Bob Holly. Which, I mean, I like Bob Holly. I've met him.
Head,
but he's not coming with a head. Yeah, so it's just it's fun. The other question we got is from Brent Carter. The Fair City Hooligan, so Hooligan Section. He mentioned in episode 6 of the critically acclaimed SWN podcast, don't know who's acclaiming them, but that's what he's written anyway. He wanted to know your thoughts on his mentioned Hooligan Battle Royal. So that would be yourself, him, Zach and Roy Knight, Alex Kozlov, Rocky Romero, Paul London, Brian Kendrick, and anyone else who calls themselves a hooligan. Do you think you could win that? What were your thoughts in going into that kind of environment? All those hooligans.
I'm going over there. I am. I'm going over. I'm winning that one. That's all it is to it.
Just chucking them all out, night-night and all that kind of stuff.
I've been using that name since probably Warzone or Attitude for the PlayStation. So it's my name. I'm having it.
Warzone Attitude. God, that brings back memories.
That's how long I've been. What, 20, 25 years ago?
Oh, it would be. Oh, no. Oh, I've ever played
my name. I'm having it.
The original hooligan.
Original of wrestling. Yeah.
Absolutely. So as far as his favourites now, of course you mentioned your growing up with all the weird and wonderful characters. Who'd be your favourites that you're watching just now, if anyone?
I've got to be honest, I don't watch that much wrestling these days. I just haven't got time for it. But me and Bradley Evans, we've got this insane love for Doc Gallows.
Right, okay.
Gallows and Anderson, just maybe it's not even so much for the wrestling, it's everything they do outside the wrestling and the promos and whatever. Just everything's just top notch. It's just, it just seems like my kind of guy I'd like to hang out with, drink a beer with.
So, yeah, so if you're going for guests for future Aberdeen Anarchy, you kind of go and get the good brothers in.
Yeah.
Meet them against the rejected. That's your main event.
That's what I'd like it to be. I think Bradley Evans would say something about it. It might be me and Bradley Evans for one night only.
Actually, kind of fits in with the face paint as well, because of course he's now got the whole face paint kind of deal as well. So could be a bit twin magic, but that's who knows? it could work. It's wrestling. Yeah. Everything works in wrestling. Mm-hmm. But so the Good Brothers is your
Good Brothers, and I've always been a big fan of AJ Styles. I always loved everything he does. I just think he's sometimes he's just criminally underused. He could be used a lot better, I think.
He's one of those guys you can put in it anywhere, pretty much.
Yeah.
I mean, not so much like the 24/7 title picture. I mean, he could probably make it work.
He deserves to be doing a lot better than what he has at some points.
He's got his big loon with him now. I have no idea what his name is. I've seen it written down, but I still can't tell you how to pronounce it.
Yeah.
So as far as aspirations go for the future, nothing's on. And by the time this goes out, there'll probably still be nothing on because we're in 2020. Any companies that you want to venture out to? Or are you quite happy in your wrestle zone, so to speak?
I mean, I've never been actively looking for bookings elsewhere other than WrestleZone. I mean, obviously, I'd listen to 10 opportunities that would crop up. I mean, we were offered that. Me and Archer were offered a booking done in, I want to say, BCW.
All right, okay. Kilmarnock-ish here.
I'm sure it was BCW. It was Looking Sharp that offered us a match down there against him and Krieger. But it was a referee, Dennis Law. It was his wedding the same night. So we'd already had hotels booked, so we could turn it down. Which is a shame because Archer's a bit younger than I am. He wants to venture out a bit more. And it's like, well, if you want to do that, it's fine. But it's.
You're happy with what you're doing.
I'm actively chasing bookings elsewhere. But like I said, if anyone did offer me anything, I would seriously consider doing it. But yeah, if I'm just doing WrestleZone for what I've got left in there, I'm happy doing that. That's fine.
I like that. So I like that story of Looking Sharp actively getting new bookings because he's one of those guys that I haven't had on the show yet. I think he's one of those people that he's been interviewed that many times. I don't think I would add anything new to his story because I've always got the impression that he's good for.
He's a genuine guy. He's a funny guy. He's got a lot of stories.
He's probably got
a lot more stories since I've last seen him.
Yeah, especially with his Denmark trips, and if anything, I would want to deep dive into his five-star wrestling adventure because I watched that weekly and was just sitting on the edge of my seat hoping they'd get a match, and then it got cancelled. So. Yeah. Did you hear anything? Because I've got Scotty next week. So he teased me in the last episode saying he's got a 5-star wrestling story. Were you approached at all for a 5-star when they were supposed to be coming up here?
Not directly, but I believe me and Archer were supposed to be involved in some capacity. I'm not entirely sure what we were supposed to be doing, but us and a couple of other wrestling guys were supposed to be involved when they were in Aberdeen or they're supposed to be in Aberdeen that one time, but yeah, we were supposed to be involved, but what we were doing, I have no idea.
I can probably just say out of just the stories and everything, they probably didn't know either until they got the call there.
It would not surprise me, yeah.
So you're just quite happy doing what you're doing. Any opponents that you'd like to see come up to Aberdeen and either face yourself in a singles match other than Doc Gallows, or in a tag team?
I mean, I'm happy fighting anyone. I don't care who I fight. I mean, we've had a lot of guys up wrestle with. As I've said, I've wrestled Andy Wilde in singles and tag matches, which he's never beat me. I'll have to say that. I think I'm 3-0 against Andy Wilde.
All right. So, yeah. I'll be sure to tag him in that just to make sure he's just watching it.
Okay, it might actually be 4-0, and it's definitely at least 3.
So
yeah.
Well, that's pretty good. I mean, by the signs of it, you wouldn't believe them even if they did approach you with a name. Just going, right, we're bringing up, I don't know, I'm trying to think of any wrestler in the moment, and everyone just gone absolutely blank. So we're bringing Crater up, because that's the one I'm picking, Crater, and you're facing him. So you're just like,
that's them all over.
You're like, ah, fine, cool, it's just whoever. Going right back to the start, then that first training session, because you're, as you said, you're a bit older. You're not as maybe not as sprightly as some of the other trainees that were there at the time. What was it like in your first training session? Was that a reality check straight away?
It was going into it and like expecting like the full setup with the ring and everything set up, and it wasn't. It was just mats. But then that first couple of weeks, I mean, it was me. And I think there was two other guys. I think they were maybe there a week or 2 weeks before I started, or they were there just before Anarchy. They started just before Anarchy. And like I said, that first few bumps, it completely takes everything away that you think about wrestling is. Especially because we were doing it on to start with, you're doing it on crash mats, but then eventually you're just doing it on the rubber match you would get at school in the gym. Just bumping on them, and it just takes the wind right out of you. That's why I think it's like the guys now we've got the academy with the ring set up all the time. That's why there's a lot more guys coming through now than there was. Like, I think when I come through, Garrick was the last one to come back before me, and I think he was there about a year before he debuted, maybe a year before I started training. Because like the guys I started training with, they dropped out maybe 2 or 3 weeks in. So then I was bumped up to the next lot of beginners who'd been there maybe 6 months more than I had been. It was a case of having to learn very quickly to keep up with the guys who had already done maybe all the fundamentals and a lot more stuff than I'd done up to that point. And then it was the same with that. It was like, maybe towards the end of the year, that first year, I was there, it was the first 6 months I was there. They'd all dropped it. So it was a case, it was just me training with either the newer trainees who'd come through or like the show ready talent. Like I said, Archer was in, he was there every week. Alan, Sterling, Damien, they were a big help because they were there most Sundays. Scotty was always there, and Thunder. It's like you're just, even if it, sometimes it was just one-on-one training, which is an immense help when you're trying to build up very quickly.
Absolutely. By the sound of it, you kind of got pushed to and fro then, because you started with the trainees, then you were bumped up, and then you became the more experienced one when they all left, and you ended up being the one trying to catch up with everyone, and then they were all gone, and then now you were far further ahead as everyone else, and it sounds like quite an intense experience.
It was. It was very much fast-tracked. At the time, when they told me I was debuting, I thought, all right, I'm ready for this. And looking back on it now, there's no idea I'm ready for it. The knowledge I've got now compared to then, it's a night and day. I can see I wasn't ready to debut then. I mean, it was a decent enough match for the level I was at the time. But I'm happy to have debuted that quickly, and I'm not, if you see what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
I could have spent more time honing things.
I always find with the WrestleZone way of getting people like kind of ready for bigger shows. Just from my own experience watching, the first match is always the worst because you're just getting yourself comfortable, acclimated. I mean, I only go to about, I probably get to about maybe the bigger shows in the year, and if you come to Keith, because it's just up the road. So I can see someone at their first match being terrible, and then I won't see them again for 6 months. So next time I see them, that for me is the telling point. So for yourself, I've probably seen you near the quite start. Of course, we've seen you at Anarchy and at the Rumble as well, because I probably was at the Rumble that year. So I would have seen you maybe a little bit Saturday, a little bit as I called another person that was at WrestleZone that's no longer there, a bit floppy like a fish, and then I would see you months later. I would see you months later, and then you've got your chest up and your head back, and you're just this confident wrestler again. So I like it's great. I like seeing that evolution of a wrestler, and I think that's why I like watching the newer guys come through WrestleZone, because I get to see them at their worst, and then I can see them flourish those months later when I go see them again. Which so I've seen it with yourself, I've seen it for many others. I've seen people go backwards and become even worse, but it's just one of those things that happen at the end of the day.
I mean, I had the benefit of an Archer either as at ringside or in a tag team match, so I always had something to fall back on. I mean, there's guys coming, some guys that have came through, and it's just that you're just a singles wrestler, and you can see that they're struggling. But like you said, having Archer there, it helped immensely. You mean, like I said, I maintain now, you look at the guys that are coming through now, like I said, just the past couple of years, the Outfit and Ryan Riley and Bradley Evans, they're leaps and bounds better when they debuted than the guys that were before them, before we had the actual training academy as such.
Yeah, so it's, well, like you're saying before, the having the ring straight away seems to be kind of fast track people a little bit more polished, you would say.
They're more properly prepared for it, I think.
Of course, yeah. I mean, if you were starting on mats and then maybe occasionally getting into the ring, like running the ropes would have been a daunting thought if you've only really done it a couple of times before an actual match itself. So, yeah, I think it would be quite intimidating.
We were just back at training about a month ago now, and see running those ropes again for the first time after having 6 months off. Oh, it's a killer.
I bet. It's
like back to training to start with. I'm nicking on this.
so, like I said, any places you want to go, you said you could be, possibly would be at BCW, but Dennis Law ruined that by getting married. But is there any places, any countries that you want to maybe give wrestling a go in? Obviously outside of going to WWE, I would assume would be the top of the list, or NXT UK maybe, or anything like that.
I mean, I'm just happy wrestling anywhere. I don't care where it was. I mean, I maintain that the Beach Ballroom is still one of the greatest venues for wrestling there is. It's a beautiful venue. And the fact that we didn't get to go there this year is, or even last year with the Leisure Centre, it was a bit of a downer. But I don't know, the wife would say otherwise. She would quickly put her foot down, I think, about going abroad. But yeah, just to see other wrestling fans in other countries would be interesting, I think.
Absolutely.
The British fans.
Just because your heavy metal background in that, that's just off the top of my head. I'm thinking like the Scandinavian countries, their wrestling scene seems to be kind of picking up.
Finland. Sweden and Norway. Yeah.
Definitely get in there and like kind of the Viking kind of feel with it. Before we wrap up, then I've noticed you've been drinking a cold beverage during this, and I'm just more nosy if anything. I've noticed on your Twitter feed that you've got quite the collection of branded beers coming through.
Yes.
Is that your kind of side hobby? You've got a bit of a beer collection going on?
I would love to say that I'm a beer connoisseur and it could tell you everything. Oh, it's got a hoppy note, then it's got citrus and this, that, next thing. I'm not. I just like beer. This is the one I've been drinking lately. It's the Motorhead Road Crew beer. And all I say about it is good beer. Enjoy it. I've bought quite a few of them over the past couple of months.
I'm the same. I like to say I'm a vodka collector, but I just see a nice bottle and go, that's a nice bottle. I'll have that. I don't even know what it tastes like. I don't even like go, I can taste the grass that it's been put through. No, I just it looks like a skull. So that's why I bought it.
Quite a lot of rum, different rums. Rum's my spirit of choice. I've gone through quite a few different flavours of like dark, spicy rums. You banana flavours and mango and whatever. I enjoy them. I could tell you a bit more about them than I can about beer.
It's fine. I mean, I think that's, for some reason, I think everyone over a certain age, say 25 or something like that, everyone's kind of developed a taste for alcohol during this lockdown period safely. They've responsibly got a taste for alcohol during this period because there's nothing else to do.
I would say I've had a taste for it during the lockdown, but I had a taste for it before.
and with that, I think seems like to be the good way to end it. I was going to make sure that I've got everything, got your undefeated streak in tables matches, which get that on a t-shirt in the future. Spoke about Motorhead, talked about your wrestler tournament of doom and that tables match, because I think if we speak any more about it, I'll end up crying again. But yeah, so where can people find you on social media?
I'm Mikkey Vago on Twitter and Facebook. I'm fairly sure I'm the only one you'll find. And I'm also on Facebook as part of The Rejected, which is me and Archer and now Caden Garrick, which has been enjoying being a three-man.
Excellent. The only thing I would say, just for my own personal thought, is get Caden started with shorts or different jeans, because I was looking at the team photo earlier, just when I was doing my research, and I was like, Archer is skinny jeans, you and your shorts, and then Caden in his baggy jeans. I'm just like, that can't be comfortable for him. Surely can't. But yeah, great stuff. Thank you very much for joining me on the finale of season one of the SWN podcast. I've had a lot of fun, and I can't wait to actually see you guys wrestling again. I'm sure once things open up and wrestlers will announce their first date, I will be there with as soon as I can be, because I've missed watching wrestling. That's just sad.
Yeah. I mean,
you're saying you haven't been watching much wrestling yourself. It's just because, well, you said time has been the killer.
Yeah, it's at the just moment, and it's just, and there's just like, there's like 30 odd hours of wrestling on a week. It's like, I can't keep up with that.
I know. My watching really has just been Thunderdome, because I like seeing my face on the screen, and that's just...
Yeah. That's big and wrong. I still keep up the pay-per-views when I can, but yeah. So you try and watch 3 hours of Raw and then another 2 hours of SmackDown every week. It's too much.
Oh, I watched Raw this week because my wife was off. Was on a sleepover. So I thought, I'll stay up and watch Raw on the Thunderdome. God, that was so long. Sitting at my work desk just going... and every so often you'd hear, here's so and so, cheer for them. sleep again. Don't recommend that for anyone. But anyway, I'm rambling now. But yeah, thank you very much for joining me on the season finale. Hopefully everyone's going to enjoy it. I'm sure they will. I would follow you on your social media, checking out Mikkey Vago. Great. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Billy.